My name is Mattia Conte. I am a PhD student in the research group of Professor Nicodemi at the University of Naples. Our group activity concerns statistical mechanics of complex systems and applications to molecular biology by using an interdisciplinary approach combining math, physics, and numerical simulations. Specifically, we study the three-dimensional structure of the DNA within the nucleus of the cells. The title of this short talk is Polymer Physics Predicts Chromosome Nuclear Structure. So let me shortly introduce you to the fundamental questions guiding our work. In the very last years, it has been discovered that our genome has a very complex, large-scale 3D structure, spanning several orders of magnitude in length scale. If we look at a length scale that is equal to the diameter of the cell nucleus, namely tens of microns, we find that each chromosome is folded into a distinct specific region of the nucleus. In this very simplified picture, each chromosome is a different color, and as you can see, each chromosome occupies a different region in the nucleus of the cell. But if we look deep inside a single chromosome, up to lengths of 10 nanometers, we find that the DNA is folded into an intricate structure of domains interacting with each other. What is truly astonishing is that this complex 3D organization of the genome is not random, but it's linked to the activity of the genes. In other words, chromosome large-scale 3D structure controls gene regulation. I want to show you just a naive picture to convince you about this recent and fundamental discovery. As you know, along the chromosome, there are some regions called genes, which produce the building blocks for the life of the cells. But along a chromosome, typically far from the gene, there are also other sites, called regulators, which physically can interact with the gene, coming in close spatial proximity with the gene itself. Now, the basic idea of gene regulation is that if the regulator is spatially close to its target gene, as happens here on the right, then the gene is active is on. Otherwise, as happens here on the left, if gene and regulator are far from each other, the gene is silent, is off. Now, the main question is, how can two DNA sites typically far from each other come in close spatial proximity in the darkness of the nucleus of the cell? So, more general, which is the fundamental molecular mechanism leading to this incredible three-dimensional genome organization? The emerging picture of chromosome folding, in which we get some relevant contributions in the last years, is the following. Consider two sites, say A and B, on a chromosome, for instance a gene and its regulator. Now, in our view, these sites come in close spatial proximity because there is a particle, technically called binder, which mediates the interactions between A and B. Similarly, C and D, if we take other two sites of DNA, C and D, we will see that those sites interact each other via a binder mediation. Those binders, in real cells, are diffusing particles corresponding to specific chemical molecules. So, the key message here is that diffusing particles mediate polymer-to-polymer long-range attractive interactions, a scenario confirmed by recent independent analysis, different independent analysis. Now, from a physics point of view, the DNA is simply a polymer, and the binders as well are molecules. Hence, the basic idea is that we can understand how the 3D structure of the genome arises starting from physics. Technically, our system Hamiltonian, contains a polymer string interacting with the molecular field, here represented by the binders. So, in other words, in our physics model, a chromosome is a polymer chain having attachment points for diffusing molecular factors, some Brownian particles called binders, which, as seen previously, can bridge together pairs of distal sites of the polymer. The idea is that if the molecular concentration of binders is low in the cell nucleus, as happens here in this very simple sketch, that the binders are not able to form stable contacts between polymer sites, and so the polymer chain is overall, say, open. Otherwise, if we increase the binder concentration, the polymer can fold into a compact closed conformation. It's easy to see, and I'm going to show you, that our polymer model, so defined, undergoes a thermodynamics phase transition upon increasing binder concentration from an open to a closed phase. We can take indeed as order parameter of this phase transition a quantity known in classical polymer physics named the gyration radius, Rg, that is the radius of a sphere roughly enclosing the volume of the polymer. If we increase binder concentration, there is a sharp drop in the gyration radius, because the polymer is folding in a more compact conformation until a plateau equilibrium value is reached. At low concentration of binders, as you can see here in this left part of the plot, the polymer system is in the open phase, where entropic forces keep the polymer in randomly folded conformation, while at high concentrations of binders, the system falls in the closed state, where the polymer self-assembles due to attractive forces mediated by a molecular field represented here by the binders. Summarizing, we discovered that chromosome folding is controlled by a thermodynamics mechanism of phase transition. This is my last slide, and here I want to show you a complication of the model to simulate real genomic regions. Indeed, in real chromosomes, the attractive interactions between binders and polymer sites are highly specific interactions. In other words, there are different types of binders that mediate different specific interactions. So, to take into account this element, this specificity of interactions, we visually represent the different types of binders by using different colors, and we allow an attractive interaction only between polymer sites and binders of the same color, having the same color. For instance, the green binders only interact with the green sites of the chain, of the polymer chain, and so on. So the question now is, which is the correct number of colors we need to model a real genomic region? And how those colors are distributed along the polymer chain? To estimate those parameters, that are the only three parameters of our model, we developed a machine learning procedure that takes as input an experimental data on the genomic region we are interested in. And this algorithm returns as output the optimal polymer model for that genomic region, namely the number of colors we need and their arrangement along the polymer chain to explain the data of the region we are studying. Once obtained from machine learning our polymer model, we ran hundreds of independent molecular dynamics simulations of our polymer model, so to obtain an ensemble of distinct independent model 3D structure of the genomic region we are studying. Importantly, without entering in so many details, the input experimental data is typically a two-dimensional matrix containing the interaction probability between two any sites of the genomic region we are studying. While our final output, that is the inference of the 3D structures of the genomic regions we are studying, is a pure model prediction, is a pure model 3D prediction. In a recent paper, which has been accepted a few days ago for publication, we successfully tested our model 3D predictions against the recent high-resolution microscopy experiments. The model 3D structure reported in this slide as examples, so the two structures that you see here, are a prediction of the real structure, are a model prediction of the real structure of the DNA in some specific kind of cells named HCT116. And those cells are well known in medicine because they are cancer cells. We feel that those kind of studies, so based on physics and computational methods, are opening a new frontier in both physics and understanding the folding mechanisms of the genome in 3D space, with potentially relevant application in medicine. This is the group I'm working in Naples. It's very nice to work with all my colleagues and Professor Nicodemi. And finally, I thank the organizer to give me the opportunity of this short video poster, and of course all of you for listening me.